Hello everyone, I'm glad to see you again. Last time we have stopped here, so in previous two sections we have seen two parts of two sections, like nervous system part one and the nervous system part two. So we have seen different types of, for instance, nervous system. Nervous system can be divided into two, central nervous system and peripheral nervous system. So in the central nervous system can be divided to brain and spinal cord. So we have seen brains last time. So brain from dorsal to ventral, we have seen different parts of the brain. From cerebrum, diencephalon, and brain, cerebrum is the two cerebral hemisphere, left and right cerebral hemisphere, and different areas of the brain, different lobes of the brain, surfaces and borders of the brain, and nervous tissue, and different characteristics, and neurons and neuroglial cells we have seen. And in the cerebrum, the next cerebrum, we have seen diencephalon, like thalamus, epithalamus, and hypothalamus. Then we have seen brain stems from midbrain, pons, and medulla oblongata, and also the last one is cerebellum, with small brain. We have seen it. Now we are starting spinal cord. And next to spinal cord, we will see autonomic nervous system in short way. So after that, we will end up central nervous system. So the spinal cord one of the parts of central nervous system, which is located within in the vertebral canal of the vertebral column. So this is the vertebral column. So this the green one is the spinal cord, which is found in the vertebral column, particularly in the vertebral canal. The canal is this one, the vertebral canal is this one, the hole. So, and this is the spinal cord. And so the spinal cord extends from the foramen magnum here, the foramen magnum, and of the occipital bone to the level of the first to second lumbar vertebrae, to L1 up to L2. So the spinal cord is emerges from the foramen magnum. It's a continuation of medulla oblongata. Then it end up with the place between lumbar 1 and lumbar 2 at this level. Lumbar 1 and lumbar 2. So the spinal cord develops more slowly than associated vertebral column. Therefore, spinal cord does not extend throughout the length of the vertebral column. So, as newborn, as a childbirth, both the spinal cord and the vertebral column have the same length. But through process, the spinal cord develops more slowly, but the vertebral column grows more fastly. So this leads to differentiates in their length. So the vertebral column goes into this area, it's long, and the spinal cord stops here because of their growth difference. Okay, the growth difference. So spinal cord is in most of population, it will end up between the lumbar 1 and lumbar 2. That's why we are taking lumbar puncture or spinal tap between lumbar 3 and lumbar 4, and sometimes between lumbar 2 and lumbar 3. And so this is a spinal cord. Seems like the intersection, it seems like this. So this is roots, this is a dorsal root, and that one is a ventral root. So after mixing one, it's also divided into rami, dorsal rami and ventral rami. And this is sections, this is outer is white or white matter, the inner, this one is the gray matter, this is the canal, This is the central canal, which is spinal canal fundus. This is anterior fissure. This is a posterior sulcus, and this is a posterior commissure. This is a anterior commissure, and this is the structure of spinal cord in general. Spinal cord is the terminal part of the spinal cord. The terminal part of the spinal cord is called conus medullaris. So this is the conus medullaris, which spinal cord is terminated here. So the terminal part of spinal cord is known as conus medullaris. And filum terminale is a fibrous strand composed of pia mater, extends inferiorly from the conus medullaris to the coccyx. So from this conus medullaris to this coccyx extended the inferior structure is known as filum terminale. Filum terminale, it is a pia mater, it is a continuation of pia mater. So spinal meninges have three maters: gray matter, arachnoid matter, and pia mater. Pia mater is the inner layer, so it's a continuation, is called filum terminale. The nerve roots also radiate inferiorly from conus medullaris through the vertebral canal. And these groups of nerves are known as cuda equini. This is a cuda equini. This is nerve roots, which is continuation in the vertebral canal. So the nerve roots are considered as cuda equini. And the pia mater extended from the conus medullaris known as filum terminale. And the terminal part of spinal cord is known as conus medullaris. Conus medullaris. So this is the dura mater and arachnoid mater. But the inner one is the pia mater. We have two enlargements. This enlargement is cervical enlargement. This enlargement is number lumbar enlargement. So this area, because it supplies a large nerve supply of the lower limb and the pelvis, it is enlarged. So that this is lumbar enlargement. This also supplies to the upper limb. So this is that's why it is enlarged. So it's known as cervical enlargement. Cervical enlargement. So these are spinal, cervical spinal nerves. This is thoracic spinal nerves, and this is lumbar spinal nerves, and finally sacral spinal nerves. Sacral spinal nerves. Cervical spinal nerves are 8, thoracic are 12, lumbar is 5, sacral is 4, coccygeal is also 1. So the other is from the posterior view. Spinal cord continues prominent enlargement. So this enlargement is cervical enlargement, lumbosacral enlargement. As I told you, this is cervical enlargement, this is lumbar enlargement. So cervical enlargement is from C3 up to T12, and the place where it enlarged of lumbosacral enlargement is lumbar 1 up to sacral 4. So this is cervical enlargement, this is lumbar enlargement, this is conus medullaris, this is filum terminale, the pia mater. So this is a brainstem. Therefore, two grooves formed by the deep anterior median fissure and shallow posterior median sulcus. So there is two grooves. So the anterior, I will show you this one. Internally, the spinal cord has inner gray matter, outer white matter. This is in reverse to the brain. The brain is composed of outer the gray matter, inner the white matter. Even if the brain contains some internal basal ganglia like gray matter, which is the core. So spinal cord is inner gray matter, for the brain is outer gray matter. So the gray matter has H-shaped in the spinal cord appearance, and H-shaped appearance in the spinal cord, gray matter. So as the center contains central canal, which used for cerebrospinal fluid circulation. Cerebrospinal fluid circulation. So I will show you. This is I'll show you later. So now we can see it. So it's prepared in short form, this handout. This is PowerPoint. So spinal cord, we do have, as I told you, cervical nerves is 8, C1 up to 8, from this one up to this one. And thoracic nerves is from T1 up to T12, from this one up to this one. And lumbar nerves is lumbar 1 up to lumbar 5, from this one up to this one. Sacral nerves is S1 up to S5, lumbar, sacral nerves is 5, just I say for the last time by mistake. So the sacral nerve is 5, so coccygeal nerve is 1. Coccygeal nerve is 1. So this is coccygeal nerve, this is sacral nerve, this is lumbar nerve, and this is thoracic nerve. This is so from this nerves, the lumbar plexus will be formed. So this cervical nerves will form cervical plexus, and also cervical and the first thoracic nerve will form brachial plexus, and lumbar nerves will form lumbar plexus, and sacral nerves with lumbar form sacral plexus. So we do have from this spinal nerves we will form four type of plexuses: cervical plexus, brachial plexus 2, lumbar plexus, and sacral plexus, 4 type of plexus. So thoracic nerves, thoracic spinal nerves does not participate in the formation of plexus, in the formation of plexus. So this is nerves with their exit. When you see this is a green one is cervical nerves, this is cervical nerves, and this one is thoracic nerves, this one is lumbar nerves, this one is sacral and coccygeal nerves. So it shows also their exit with their vertebral column. So there are 8 nerves, C1, C2, C3, up to C8 nerves, but the bone is cervical vertebra is 7, C1 up to C7. So each nerve is exits above each bone. So C1 nerve above C1 bone, C2 nerve above C2, C2 nerve above C2 bone, above it will leave above its corresponding bone. But the 8 nerve is exits below the C7 vertebra, cervical vertebra. So all C1 up to C7 nerves are exits above its corresponding bone, but only C8 is below C7 vertebra. And the others also, T1 up to T12 nerve, also this nerves, also thoracic nerves, leaves the bone below its corresponding vertebra, the same vertebra. So the other, this is lumbar nerves. Lumbar nerves also exists with the same vertebra. T1 as exists below L1 with below L2. The other is sacral. The sacral is also, this is sacral nerves. Sacral nerves also exists the spinal cord by passing through sacral foramen. We do have four into groups. We do have four types of foramina: anterior sacral foramina and posterior sacral foramina with four holes. Okay, with four holes. So this is it gives a hint for exit of spinal nerves from their vertebral column. In origin of spinal cord, okay, spinal cord. So this is sectional organization. After you sectioned the spinal cord, you will have a structure or surface just like this. This is a gray hair or gray matter. This is the outer is known as the white matter. So this fissure is known as anterior median fissure. This known as posterior median sulcus. But the place, this one is known as posterior gray commissure, and this one is known as anterior gray commissure. This is anterior gray commissure. This is anterior gray commissure. This one anterior white commissure, anterior white commissure, and this one and also this is posterior median sulcus. This is the posterior, this is the posterior gray commissure. So this is the center one is known as central canal. This center one is central canal. So after the midway, this spinal cord is divided into three columns. From this one up to this one known as anterior white column. From this one up to this one is lateral white column. From this one up to this one is posterior white column. Posterior white column when we see this gray matter or the gray matter, the inner gray matter, this horn is known as posterior gray horn, and this horn is known as anterior gray horn, whereas this horn is known as lateral gray horn. So posterior gray horn, lateral gray horn, and anterior gray horn. So when you see, this is a ventral root, this is dorsal root. So this area is known as somatic sensory. This area is known as a place for arising somatic, a place for controlling somatic sensory. This is a root or contains nuclei, which is responsible for visceral sensory. This is visceral motor. This one is somatic sensory, visceral sensory, and visceral motor, somatic motor. So this is anterior ventral root or anterior horn is contains motors, visceral and somatic motor, whereas the posterior one is contains somatic sensory and visceral sensory. Visceral sensory, the other one is so horns of spinal cord, let us see the horn. Horns of horns are this one. Let us see posterior or lateral anterior horns. When we see the horns, posterior gray horn contains somatic and visceral sensory. This is the posterior horn, or this one is a posterior horn, so contains somatic and visceral sensory. So anterior gray horn is deals with somatic motor control. Somatic motor, anterior gray horn is deals with somatic motor control, whereas lateral gray horn is contain visceral motor neuron. Visceral motor neuron. So visceral motor neuron is found in the lateral gray horn. Somatic motor control is found on anterior gray horn, whereas somatic and visceral sensory is found in the posterior gray horn. So gray commutators contains axons that cross from one side to the other. This is the gray commutators axons from one side to the other. There's gray commutators. Gray commutator means anterior gray commutator and posterior gray commutator. Gray commutator is also axon close one to the other. Especially gray white commutator. The other is function of the spinal cord. One of the functions of spinal cord is impulse conduction, used as the pathway for impulse transmission. So through two routes, ascending tractus and descending tractus. Through ascending tractus, nerve impulse transmits from peripheral sensory to the brain. Through descending tractus from the brain to the effector organs like muscles and gland. So spinal cord contains two tractus, like descending and ascending tractus. Ascending tractus receives information from peripheral organs like sensory information, and it will transmit into the brain. Whereas descending is receives information or order command from the brain, and it will send into muscles and glands, like effector organs like this. The second type of function is the reflex integration center for spinal reflexes, like swallowing, coughing, sneezing, and vomiting. The other is lumbar puncture, or another name is lumbar tap. This is not function, but lumbar tap is clinically lumbar procedure, or lumbar puncture or spinal tap is will be made. So in the case of infection in central nervous system, for instance, like meningitis, lumbar puncture will be made to get cerebrospinal fluid from spinal from the spinal cord. So in this case, lumbar puncture is made between this lumbar 3 and lumbar 4, when the person lies in this incurved way. So between the lumbar 3, lumbar 3, lumbar 4, there is a place where a needle will be inserted. So lying in just like this shape is will separate the lumbar vertebrae. So it's it widens between them. It will be widened between them so that lumbar puncture is between lumbar 3 and lumbar 4, and will also it can be made between lumbar 2 and lumbar 3, because spinal cord in most of individuals spinal cord terminates between lumbar 1 and lumbar 2. Even in some individuals it may be reaches up to lumbar 2, so it can be made between lumbar 2 and lumbar 3, and it can be made between lumbar 3 and lumbar 4. But the most safe area is between lumbar 3 and lumbar 4. You cannot touch the spinal cord in this place, so you can easily receive the cerebrospinal fluid, and you can send for examination whether there is CNS infection or not. So lumbar puncture made is between lumbar 3 and lumbar 4. The other is preferential nervous system consists of sensory and motor neurons. Sensory neurons collect information and convey to central nervous system, while motor neurons convey information from CNS and send to muscle and glands. The preferential nervous system can be divided structurally into two parts, cranial nerves and spinal nerves and ganglia. So preferential nervous system contains cranial nerves and spinal nerves. So cranial nerves is 12, it arises from the cranium, from the brain, and spinal nerves are 31 pairs. It will arise, they are arising from the spinal cord. So this is considered as preferential nervous system. So when we see the cranial nerves, they are 12, so arise from the brain. There are 12 cranial nerves named into superior to inferior in sequence from cranial nerve 1 up to cranial nerve 12 in sequence from superior to inferior. For instance, let me name them. The first cranial nerve 1 is olfactory nerve, the second one is optic nerve, the third one is oculomotor nerve, the fourth one is abducens, the fourth one is trochlear nerve, the fifth is trigeminal nerve, the sixth is abducens nerve, the seventh is facial nerve, the eighth is oculovestibular nerve, the ninth is glossopharyngeal nerve, 10 is vagus nerve, 11 is spinal accessory nerve, and the 12 is hypoglossal nerve. This is in order from superior to inferior sequence or position. Have three general categories of cranial nerve function. This is sensory. So cranial nerve divided to three functions. Some are somatic motor, some are parasympathetic, and some are mixed. For instance, cranial nerve 1, cranial nerve 2, and cranial nerve 8 is sensory, have sensory function. And also cranial nerve 3, 4, 6, and 11 is motor, and also 5, 7, 9, 10 are both mixed, sensory and mixed characteristics. So sensory functions include special senses like vision, cranial nerve 2, general senses such as touch, pain, and face. Somatic motor functions refers to control of skeletal muscles. And parasympathetic function involves regulation of glands, smooth muscles, and cardiac muscle. So there are 12 pairs of cranial nerves which leave the brain and passes through foramina, and fissures in the skull. Different types of foramina in the skull. There is fissures, foramina in the skull. So passes through that and innervates the face and the skin around the skull, the face, and some nerves will pass into the neck, and only one nerve going to the abdomen, that's vagus nerve. All nerves are distributed in the head and neck, except cranial nerve 10, which also supplies structures of the thorax and abdomen. It will go into small intestine and large intestine, by the way. Vagus nerve is having an extensive course, and the longest nerve in the cranial nerves, vagus nerve. So vagus nerve also having sensory and motor function. And from superior to inferior. This is the base of cerebral hemisphere. This is the encephalon. This is the brainstem. So this is the medial obligata and also the lower part, spinal cord. So from superior to inferior, we can name them. So the first one is this one is known as olfactory bulb. Olfactory bulb. So the nerves are, this is filaments of olfactory nerve. This is the bulb. This is the nerve. So this is cranial nerve one. And the other is the olfactory tract. Here is the tract. The other is optic nerve, olfactory two. This is optic nerve next to olfactory nerve. And the third one is oculomotor nerve, cranial nerve three. This is oculomotor nerve, cranial nerve three in sequence order. The other is trochular nerve, cranial nerve four. This is the cranial nerve four. This is pairs, left and right, left and right, left and right. So this is cranial nerve four or trochular nerve. The other is trigeminal nerve or cranial nerve five. Trigeminal nerve or five. This is trigeminal nerve or cranial nerve five. This is also its pair. Finally, abducens nerve six. This is the six within its pair. Within its pair. So the six nerve is this one. And also the seven facial nerve. Seven facial nerve is this one. And the pair is this one. And the other is the eighth one is the vestibulocochlear nerve, cranial nerve eight. This is cranial nerve eight. This is cranial nerve eight. So the eight is found here. Nine is glossopharyngeal nerve. This is the root for glossopharyngeal nerve. This is the pair, its pair. And the other is vagus nerve. Vagus nerve, this is vagus nerve, and this is its pair. This is its pair. The other one is that also hypoglossal nerve. This is hypoglossal nerve, cranial nerve 12. And finally, axillary nerve or cranial nerve 11 is this one. This one is axillary nerve. This one is axillary nerve. So this is are the 12 cranial nerves where they arise from the brain, okay? The brain. So when you see their number, two, cranial nerve and cranial nerve one and two are from the cerebrum. Cranial nerve three and four are from the midbrain. From five up to eight is from the cone. From eight up to 12 is from the medial obligata. So now let us see the first cranial nerve is olfactory nerve, cranial nerve one. It is a nerve of smell. It passes the foramina, cribriform plate of ethmoid bone, and comes into the superior portion of the nasal cavity. So it's the receptors is found on the superior part of the nasal cavity, so it's used as for senses. So that area is known as olfactory epithelium, that is sensitive for smell. The second one is optic nerve or cranial nerve 2. This is the nerve of sight. This is the nerve of sight used for vision. Used for vision, connecting retina with the brain. Connecting retina with the brain. So optic nerve is a nerve of sight which arises from retina, the area which is the posterior portion of the eyeball in the retina, and they will take sensory information to the brain, especially on the posterior part of the brain, site of vision, on the occipital lobe of the brain. The other is the oculomotor nerve, cranial nerve 3. It is the name indicates the nerve that moves the eye. It passes through superior orbital fissure. By the way, in the eye, two types of fissure, superior orbital fissure and inferior orbital fissure. So oculomotor nerve passes in the superior orbital fissure to reach in the eye. So damage to this nerve, damage to the oculomotor nerve, causes a clinical condition called ptosis. Ptosis is a condition which leads to dropping of the upper eyelid due to paralysis of levator palpebrae superioris. So paralysis of levator palpebrae superioris or dropping of the upper eyelid is known as ptosis. pitosis. So in this case, the upper LED will cover your ass, because of it cannot be contract or constrict because of paralysis of this nerve. This is the third cranial nerve. Therefore, this trochlear nerve, cranial nerve 4, it is the smallest cranial nerve, whereas the largest cranial nerve is cranial nerve 5 or trigeminal nerve. It supplies only one A muscle. This is known as superior oblique muscle. We have 6 A muscles, extrinsic A muscles. So from the 6, superior oblique muscle is supplied by trochlear nerve. The foramen which this nerve passes is superior orbital fissure with oculomotor, abducens nerve, and ophthalmic nerve. So structures like ophthalmic nerve, abducens nerve, oculomotor nerve passes through superior orbital fissure. The other is the trigeminal nerve, cranial nerve 5. This is the largest cranial nerve, and it's a mixed nerve, mixed both motor and sensory fibers. So trigeminal nerve has 3 branches. The first branch is known as ophthalmic branch or V1. The second one is maxillary branch or V2. The third is mandibular branch or V3. Ophthalmic nerve or V1 is this one. So this area is supplied by V1 or ophthalmic nerve, whereas this area, this yellow area, is a V2. This area is supplied by the maxillary nerve, whereas the V3 mandibular nerve is supplied this area and around the mandible. So ophthalmic nerve passes the foramen through superior orbital fissure. The function is purely sensory and supplies superior region of the face. As you know, this is the sensory sensation. Sensory supplies of this superior region of the face, this area, including nose, eye, brow, and this area is sensory supply of this area is done by ophthalmic nerve. Whereas maxillary nerve passes through the foramen or tandem, this function purely sensory. So this is sensory. For instance, if a person stabs by stabs in this area, and this area is affected, and after affection or after an injury, if a person is unable to detect sensory receptions like cold and hot, so the probability of damaging the nerve is maxillary nerve, because sensory innervation of this area is by maxillary nerve. The other is mandibular nerve, V3, this area. Mandibular nerve is a nerve which passes the foramen through foramen ovale. Then function, it is a mixed nerve as motor and sensory. So supplies the teeth, the lower lip, this is the lower lip, teeth, and the lower face region here, and muscles of mastication, which is used for masticate the food. So supply this mandibular nerve. So skin area is by sensory, and the muscles are supplied by the motor part. So mandibular nerve has both sensory and motor function. So this is its branches. The sixth nerve is abducens nerve or cranial nerve 6, passes through the foramen superior orbital fissure. So the function is to supply lateral rectus muscle that abducts the eye. So lateral rectus, from the 6 extrinsic eye muscles, lateral rectus muscle is supplied by abducens nerve, used for abduct the eye. To abduct the eye, the seventh cranial nerve is facial nerve. Facial nerve is, as we discussed, it's a mixed nerve with motor root and sensory root. Motor is the largest part, and also passes through the foramen stylomastoid foramen. So we can divide facial nerve into 5 terminal branches. The first terminal branch is temporal, the second is zygomatic, the third is buccal, the fourth is mandibular, and the fifth is surgical branch. Surgical branches, the function of the facial nerve is motor part supplies the most muscles of the face. Muscles of the face is supplied by motor branch of the facial nerve, whereas the sensory part, the sensory part supplies special taste from anterior to third of the tongue. Anterior to third of the tongue, whereas the posterior one is the posterior part of the tongue supplied by glossopharyngeal nerve, but anterior to third of the tongue is supplied, special taste supplied by the sensory part of the facial nerve. The sensory part of the facial nerve. So to know the distributions of the terminal branches of the facial nerve, we will put our hands just like this in the face. So this, the little finger, shows how the temporal nerve distributes and supplies this region, and also this finger also shows the zygomatic nerve, how zygomatic nerve supplies the zygomatic region, and the third, this finger shows how the buccal nerve supplies this type of buccal region, so this, the fourth finger shows the mandibular nerve, so how the mandibular nerve distributes and supplies this mandibular region. Finally, this, the fifth branch, is known as cervical branch or cervical nerve. This cervical nerve goes into the neck and supplies the neck region. Accessory cervical nerve, it supplies just like this, the cervical branch of the facial nerve supplies this region, the neck. So our putting our left hand in this way shows the distributions of the five terminal branches of the facial nerve. Then the eighth one is known as the vestibulocochlear nerve or cranial nerve 8. It's composed of two parts. The one is vestibular part, the other is cochlear part, as the name indicates, vestibulocochlear part. So the vestibular part is used for maintaining balance, whereas the cochlear part is used for hearing. So the hearing part is processed by cochlear part, whereas the balance is the vestibular part. So this vestibulocochlear nerve passes the foramen through internal acoustic meatus in the ear. So the nine cranial nerve is known as glossopharyngeal nerve or cranial nerve 9. This is passes through the foramen, jugular foramen. So glossopharyngeal nerve passes from the medulla oblongata to the face and the neck by the foramen. It's called jugular foramen. So glossopharyngeal nerve is function for swallowing, salivation, sensation from the tongue and pharynx. So the posterior part of the sensations from the posterior of the tongue is by this nerve. The tenth cranial nerve is known as vagus nerve, cranial nerve. This nerve has the more extensive course and distribution than any other cranial nerve. It's the longest nerve from the cranial nerves, and not only their length but also having extensive course and distribution. It supplies the structures in the neck, thorax, as well as the abdomen. So abdomen supplies liver, small intestine, and parts of large intestine, and stomach also. And the other is, so the other concept is the vagus nerve is passes the, through the foramen, passes the in foramen through jugular foramen. That foramen is called jugular foramen. So it supplies the stomach, as I told you, the stomach, by forming anterior and posterior division in the liver, first part of duodenum, and the pancreas is supplied by the vagus nerve. That's majority of small intestine supplied by vagus nerve. So the vagus nerve branches into, vagus nerve also will give two branches in the neck region, or on the beginning of thoracic, the trunk will give two branches, the superior, not only two branches, also will give many branches. The first branch is superior laryngeal nerve, superior laryngeal nerve. The second is recurrent laryngeal nerve. The other is cardiac branch to the heart, pulmonary branch to the lung, and abdominal branch, which will go into the abdomen. This is the extensive course of the vagus nerve. It's a very important nerve. So the other is the 11th cranial nerve is axillary nerve, axillary spinal nerve. So this has cranial and spinal root, So the spinal root arises from the cervical region and enters the skull through foramen magnum, and in the cranium it joins with cranial root and exits through jugular foramen to enter the neck. So the spinal root is arise from below the foramen magnum from the spinal part, so it will pass as in ascending order into the through the foramen magnum and will join its cranial root, and again it will exit through jugular foramen to enter to the neck downward. So the cranial root arises from the medulla oblongata. Above 8 cranial nerves, they will arise from the medulla oblongata. The spinal root supply trapezius muscle and sternocleidomastoid muscle. Trapezius muscle and sternocleidomastoid muscle is supplied by the spinal root of axillary nerve. Then the last nerve is the last cranial nerve is hypoglossal nerve. Hypoglossal nerve is purely motor, originates from medulla oblongata, leaves the cranial cavity, so hypoglossal canal, its own canal, is known as hypoglossal canal. So supply intrinsic and extrinsic muscles of the tongue, except glottoglossus. Except glossoglossus, all intrinsic and extrinsic muscles of the tongue is supplied by hypoglossal nerve. Whereas plautoglossus is supplied by pharyngeal branch of vagus nerve. So this is important table to compare the 12 cranial nerves in name and based on their sensory, motor, and parasympathetic. So cranial nerve 1, cranial nerve 2, cranial nerve 8 is purely sensory, but sensory fibers are found on the cranial nerve 1, cranial nerve 2, cranial nerve 5, cranial nerve 7, and cranial nerve 9, cranial nerve 10, having sensory fibers, but the pure is 3, whereas cranial nerve 3, cranial nerve 6, and cranial nerve 11, cranial nerve 12 is purely motor, but in mixed form, motor fibers are found on the fascial, and or cranial nerve 7, cranial nerve 9, cranial nerve 10 will be found. But mixed nerve having both sensory and motor is cranial nerve 5, trigeminal both, and fascial both, and glossopharyngeal both, and vagus both. So cranial nerve 5, 7, 9, and 10 are mixed. Whereas parasympathetic, cranial nerves which have parasympathetic fiber have is oculomotor nerve 1, fascial nerve 2, and glossopharyngeal nerve 3, and vagus nerve is 4, this force R contains parasympathetic fibers. Parasympathetic fibers. Parasympathetic fibers. So, at the same time, cranial nerves, which have both sensory, motor, and parasympathetic, is the three things. The one is from the three things is fascial nerve. Yes. So fascial nerve have sensory, motor, and parasympathetic. At the same time, glossopharyngeal nerve have glossopharyngeal nerve has sensory, motor, and parasympathetic, whereas vagus nerve has the three. So three cranial nerves have three: parasympathetic, motor, sensory. So this is details about the cranial nerves. Finally, purely sensory nerves 1, 2, and 8. Purely motor nerves 3, 4, 6, 11, and 12. Mixed motor and sensory nerves, as I told you, 5, 7, 9, and 10. Parasympathetics 3, 7, 9, 10. 3, 7, 9, 10. This is 3, 7, 9, 10, as I told you. The other is, this is all about the cranial nerves. Now we are starting spinal nerves. We have 31 pairs of nerves, 8 cervical from C1 up to C8, 12 thoracic, C1 up to 12, 5 lumbar, lumbar 1 up to lumbar 5, sacral, sacral 1 up to sacral 5, so 5, 12, 5, 5, 10, 22, 30, so 1 coxygeal nerve is 31 pair. So mixed nerve attached to the spinal cord. At its origin, the spinal nerve has two roots. At its origin, the spinal two roots, anterior and posterior roots. Posterior roots. This is the spinal cord. This is the vertebra, cervical, or this is the cervical vertebra, and this is the pia mater, then arachnoid mater, then the outer is dura mater. This is known spinal meninges for spinal cord, and cranial meninges for cranium or the brain. So this is the vertebra. This is dorsal root ganglia. So dorsal root ganglia. And also there is, this one is ventral root, this one is dorsal root. Both have ventral and dorsal root, the left and the right, dorsal and ventral root. So this is the body of the vertebra. This is what I have seen before: cervical nerves, thoracic nerves, lumbar and sacral nerves. So now, as the origin of the spinal cord, we have two roots: ventral root and dorsal root. Ventral root is composed of motor fibers, axons of nerve cells in the anterior horn and lateral horn. Yes, anterior horn, axons from anterior horn and lateral horn is motor, they are motor fibers. This forms the ventral root, whereas sensory fibers are forms the dorsal root. So has sensory fibers have swelling. This swelling is known as dorsal root ganglia or posterior root ganglia, where the cell bodies of sensory neurons are found. So this is the ventral root, this is the dorsal root. So this is the swelling area. This is known as dorsal root ganglia because it's swelling. This is swelling, so it's known as dorsal root ganglia. This ganglia is for cell body of sensory nerves. So cell body outside CNS is known as ganglia. So spinal nerve is formed as the fibers from posterior and anterior roots converge and emerge through an intervertebral foramen. So before emerging through the vertebral canal, they have anterior dorsal root. After that, they will emerge and form one spinal nerve. Then this spinal nerve passes through intervertebral foramen. So yeah, let me show you. This is a gray matter, this is a white matter, this is a this is a fissure, anterior fissure, this is a posterior sulcus. So this is a gray matter contains these all structures. White matter contains, white matter divided into three parts: posterior funiculus, anterior funiculus, and lateral funiculus. So posterior this one, so posterior this one, anterior this one, and lateral is this one. And the gray matter is gray commissure, it's gray commissure. And posterior dorsal horn is this one, lateral horn, lateral horn is this one, anterior or ventral horn is this one. So this is a gray matter division. So this is a dark area is gray, the white area is the white matter, white column or white matter. So this is the center one, is on a central canal. This is anterior median fissure, this is posterior median sulcus. So now when we come to this point, this is spinal cord, nerves arise from the spinal cord. So this is forms two roots, this is ventral root, motor, and this is dorsal root, sensory. This is ganglia, dorsal root ganglia. So they will merge one nerve and exit through intervertebral foramen. This nerve is known as spinal nerve after merging, because sensory and motor form together and they will leave the vertebral canal or vertebral column through intervertebral foramen. So first they have two roots, then they will divide into two rames, anterior and posterior rames. We will see later. So this is dura matter, this is arachnoid matter, whereas the inner one is the pia matter. So if you think that this is spinal cord, this is a fissures, sulcus fissures. So when we divide this one, this is rootus, anterior root, posterior root is dorsal root ganglia. So if you think that this is the nucleus, so that this is somatic sensory, this is the somatic sensory, this is the visceral sensory, this is known as sensory part, this is visceral motor, this is somatic motor, this is motors. So this is ventral horn, this is anterior, or this is ventral horn, this is lateral horn, this is a posterior horn. So that's the same thing. When we see this, these fibers are known as sensory, somatic sensory neuron, and this one is known as, this one, the green one, is known as visceral sensory neuron, whereas this, the yellow one, is known as visceral motor neuron, whereas SM means somatic motor, the red one is somatic motor neuron. So these neurons are merged as spinal nerve and this area. So this is ventral, this is dorsal root, this is anterior horn, motor neurons. Now spinal nerve trunk is very short, it divides into two rami. So after exiting from the vertebral column, divide into two rami, ventral or anterior ramus and dorsal or posterior ramus. This is mixed, by the way, because it contains both sensory and motor fibers. So the motor and sensory fibers supply the muscles and the skin of the back of the trunk. This means the sensory supplies the skin of the back, whereas the motor supplies the muscles of the back. This is dorsal ramus. Dorsal rami plural. So the other is ventral or anterior ramus, having supply muscle and the skin, and lateral and anterior side of the trunk. So in this way, the motor fiber supplies the muscles of ventral trunk and lateral trunk. Lateral means side, ventral means like chest and abdomen ridge, whereas the sensory fiber supply the skin, which is found superficial or external of the abdomen, thoracic, and the lateral parts of the trunk. So combinations of anterior rami innervate the limbs. Do you know? Now posterior rami supplies the back of the back structures of our trunk, so their function is limited on there. Whereas anterior rami is, in addition to supplying the lateral and anterior portion of the trunk, it also forms plexuses and supplies the upper limb and the lower limb. The upper limb is supplied by brachial plexus, the lower limb is plexus by sacral and lumbar plexus. So the four types of plexuses, like cervical plexus, brachial plexus, thoracic and brachial plexus, lumbar and sacral plexus, arise from anterior rami, arise from combination of anterior rami, from C1 nerves up to sacral nerves, up to sacral nerves. As I told you, this is before, after form short trunk, or this is spinal nerve, they will also form another branch, this one known as rami. So this is the ventral rami, this is the dorsal rami, this is the ventral rami. So in this case, they will also, they are also mixed. So after that, directly they will go into skin for sensation and muscles. So motors are going for muscles and sensory parts are for skin. So this is axons of motor neuron. So this is sensory. So motor sensory. Finally, let us see nerve plexus. Nerve plexus are networks of nerves formed from ventral anterior rami, or anterior rami of spinal nerves, except in the thoracic nerves from T2 to T12. T1 is participate for in the brachial plexus, but from T2 to T12 it is not participate for brachial plexus formation. So except in the thoracic nerves of T12 up to T2 up to T12, the ventral rami of spinal nerves combined and then split again as networks of nerves. This is referred to as plexus. So the ventral rami of the spinal nerves combine, then splits again as networks of nerves. This is known as plexus. So there are four types of plexuses, which is formed from ventral rami of spinal nerves. So the first plexus is known as cervical plexus. Cervical plexus is formed from C1 up to C4. And in some portions of C5. So C1 up to C4 is formed cervical plexus, found deep in the neck under sternocleidomastoid muscle, and innervates the skin and muscles of the neck and posterior head and shoulder ridge. So having sensory and motor division, that's why, because of the skin and muscles, it's a place, skin and muscles. So cervical plexus having cutaneous branch or sensory branch or superficial branch and motor or deep branch. When you see cutaneous branches, it can divide into cutaneous branches. One is lesser occipital nerve, the second is greater auricular nerve, the third is transverse cervical nerve, the fourth is supraclavicular nerve. Supraclavicular nerve have also three branches, anterior, middle and posterior branch. So also lesser occipital is formed also ventral rami of C2 and C3, and greater auricular also formed ventral rami of C2 and C3, and transverse cervical is formed from ventral rami of C2 and C3, and supraclavicular is formed from ventral rami of C3 and C4, and lesser occipital is used for to supply skin on posterior lateral aspect of the neck. Skins on the posterior aspect of the neck supplied by lesser occipital, whereas skin on the ear, skin over parotid gland is supplied by greater auricular nerve, and skin on the anterior and lateral aspect of the neck is supplied by transverse cervical nerve, whereas skin of shoulder and clavicular region is supplied by supraclavicular nerve, supraclavicular nerve, and the other is deep branch motor. By the way, ansa cervicalis is a very important loop which supplies motor which gives motor branch to the neck muscles, like pyramid muscles. So ansa cervicalis having superior and inferior roots. These two roots form the loop, ansa cervicalis loop. So motor branch of or ansa cervicalis is formed from ventral rami of C1 up to C3, supply infrahyoid muscles of the neck like omohyoid, sternohyoid, and sternothyroid muscles, whereas segmental and other muscular branches of these motor branches arise from C1 up to C5, deep muscles of the neck like genioid, thyroid, and portions of scaling muscle, levator scapula muscle, trapezius, and sternocleidomastoid is by separated by deep branch or segmental branches of motor branches. The other important nerve is pharynx nerve. Pharynx nerves arise from the ventral rami of C3 up to C5 spinal nerves and supplies mostly diaphragm. Sole motor nerve supply. The sole motor nerve supply of diaphragm is pharynx nerve. Pharynx nerve. So our diaphragm is solely separated by the pharynx nerve. Pharynx nerve is also motor branch of or deep branches of cervical plexus. Cervical plexus. So ansa cervicalis is the deep branch or motor branch of cervical plexus. It is a nerve loop lying in front of the common carotid artery in the neck. Superficial to common carotid artery is we can find ansa cervicalis has two roots, anterior root and posterior root. Anterior root is made up of fibers from C1, whereas posterior roots arise from C2 and C3. So innervate all infrahyoid muscles except thyrohyoid muscle. Thyrohyoid muscle is supplied by C1 anterior rami from superior root. So except thyrohyoid muscle, all infrahyoid muscle is supplied by ansa cervicalis muscle. So ansa cervicalis muscle is this one, the superior root is arise from C1. So like this. This is the superior root, whereas inferior roots arise from the C2 and C3, and it forms this. This is the inferior root. This is the superior root. In general, they will form loop. They will form so C1, C2, C3 is participating in the formation of this loop. So these branches are the branches which goes into infrahyoid muscles. Infrahyoid muscles. So this one known as ansa cervicalis. In general, this is known as cervical plexus. It arises from ventral rami of C1. This one is C1. And C2. This one is C2. C3. This one is C3. C4. This one is C4. C5 is this one, but the branches, the portion of C5 is this one. So some branches of C5 is participating this way, and mainly is goes to the lower part. So C5 is participated. So used to give us pharynx nerve. So the portion of C5, C4, C3 is forms as cervical plexus. Cervical plexus. So at same time, cervical plexus forms this axillary nerve. This axillary nerve is formed from cervical plexus. So yeah, this seems like that. So the second type of plexus is brachial plexus. Lesser hospital nerve, greater auricular nerve, transverse cutaneous nerve, ansa cervicalis, axillary nerve, pharynx nerve, supraclavicular nerve, all branches of cervical plexus. So brachial plexus is arise from C5 up to T1. C5 up to T1, found partly in the neck, partly in the axilla. Some portions of brachial found in the neck, the base, and some are found in the axilla. So brachial plexus, the nerves which arise from brachial plexus innervates the upper limb, shoulder, and the neck muscles. So structurally divide into, by the way, brachial plexus divide into roots, roots ventral and dorsal, like then trunk, then it will divide into divisions, then cortex, finally terminal branch. Finally it gives us terminal branch. So This one is C5. The portion C5 portion is from brachial plexus, so forms brachial from the C5, C7, C8, and T1. This is known as root. Root. Finally, it will give us trunk. It will give us trunk. Then it will give us division. And finally, it gives us cords. Finally, this gives us terminal branches. Terminal branches like ulnar nerve, median nerve, radial nerve, musculocutaneous nerve, axillary nerve. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So these 5 nerves are the terminal branches of this. The terminal branches of this brachial plexus. So this is rootus. This is trunk, upper trunk, middle trunk, inferior trunk. Finally, it will divide into divisions. These divisions are having 3 divisions: anterior, posterior division. Then this cordis. Cords also lateral, posterior, medial cord. Finally, terminal branches will give us. Let me show you the best thing. So. The yellow one anterior division, this red one is posterior division. So this one is trunks, this one is roots in color. So yeah, this is very best picture. Just I will recommend you to keep in your mind this distribution. So first there is roots, ventral rami roots. This roots, so brachial plexus arise from C5, C6, C7, C8, and T1 roots. So this is roots, ventral rami roots. So roots C5 and C6 will form upper trunk. Roots C7 solely or separately, it will form middle trunk. And C8 and T1, it will form lower trunk. So we do have 3 types of trunks: upper trunk, middle trunk, and lower trunk. Then upper trunk will give us 2 divisions, anterior division and posterior division. The middle trunk will give us 2 divisions, anterior and posterior division. The same thing, the lower trunk will give us anterior and posterior division. So all trunks having anterior posterior division. Finally, cords. We will have 3 cords: lateral cord, medial cord, and posterior cord. So by the way, the anterior division of the upper trunk and the anterior divisions of the middle trunk will give us lateral cords. The second thing is the anterior division of the lower trunk will give us the medial cord. But the 3 division, the posterior divisions of upper trunk, the posterior division of middle trunk, the posterior division of lower trunk will give us posterior cord. So I will repeat it. Anterior division of the upper trunk and anterior division of the middle trunk will give us lateral cord, whereas the anterior divisions of the lower trunk will give us middle cord, whereas the posterior divisions of upper, middle, and lower trunk will give us posterior cord. So we have 3 cords: lateral, medial, and posterior cord. Lateral cord will give us musculocutaneous. Lateral cord will give us musculocutaneous nerve and median nerve. Lateral cord will give us musculocutaneous nerve, whereas the median nerve will give us. Musculocutaneous nerve will arise from the lateral cord. Ulnar nerve will arise from the medial cord. Whereas the median nerve will arise from the lateral and the medial cord. So it forms M shape. M shape, so M alphabet, so M letter. So musculocutaneous will arise from lateral, ulnar will arise from medial, and medianis will arise from the lateral and the medial cord. So, and also radial nerve will arise from posterior cord, axillary nerve will arise from posterior cord. So finally, the major terminal branches of peripheral nerves are 5. Musculocutaneous nerve, median nerve, ulnar nerve, radial nerve, auxiliary nerve are the outputs of this brachial plexus, the terminal nerves of brachial plexus. These nerves are supplies the axillary shoulder region and the upper limb. So the nerves of brachial plexus, musculocutaneous nerve, having muscular branch and cutaneous branch. The muscular branch supplies biceps brachii, brachialis muscle, and coracobrachialis, whereas cutaneous branch supplies the skin on the anterolateral forearm. Median nerve, the muscular branch supplies to flexor group of anterior forearm, with exception of flexor carpal naris and ulnar two heads of flexor distal and profundus. In the hand, first and second lubricants, cutaneous branch supplies the skin on the palm side of the first, second, third and half of the fourth finger is supplied by cutaneous branch. The skin on the palm side of the first to the fourth half is having sensory reception from this area. So in the hand, first and second lumbricus. So this is a median nerve supply. So the third one is ulnar nerve. So ulnar nerve has, as like others, like having muscular branch and cutaneous branch. Ulnar muscular branch supplies flexor carpal naris and ulnar two heads of flexor digitalis profundus, which is not supplied by median nerve or interossei muscle, medial to lumbricalis, and or hypothenar muscles and adductor pollicis is supplied by ulnar nerve. So cutaneous branch gives sensory innervation for skin on the palm side of sides of half of fourth and fifth finger, on the dorsal side of fifth and half fourth finger. The fourth finger is axillary nerve. Axillary nerve is formed from C5 and C6, having cutaneous branch and muscular branch. The cutaneous branch supplies the skin on the shoulder and shoulder joint, whereas the muscular branch supplies deltoid muscle and teres minor muscle. Axillary muscle supplies deltoid and teres minor muscle as motor branch. So the fifth is the radial nerve. Radial nerve is this one, radial nerve. So radial nerve is having muscular branch and cutaneous branch. The muscular branch is posterior muscles of supply posterior muscles of the arm, forearm, the hand. All posterior muscles of the arm, like triceps brachii and anconus, forearm and hand, all muscles. Cutaneous branch supplies the skin on the posterior lateral surface of the entire limb, upper limb, in the hand dorsal side of the first, second, third and fourth half of finger, which is not supplied by ulnar nerve, the place which is left by ulnar nerve. So this is having radial nerve, sensory and motor innervation. So this nerve is radial nerve, this nerve is muscular cutaneous nerve, and this nerve is ulnar nerve. This is the middle one, is the median nerve. So ulnar nerve and median nerve is on the front, radial nerve is on the back, musculocutaneous is on the upper arm mostly, and skin for the forearm. So the third plexus is known as lumbar plexus. Lumbar plexus is formed by anterior rami of spinal nerves from lumbar 1 up to lumbar 4, and some fibers from T12. So lumbar 1 up to lumbar 4 form lumbar plexus. The nerves that arise from the lumbar plexus innervate the structures of lower abdomen, 1, anterior and the medial portion of the lower extremity is the lumbar plexus. Anterior is by femoral nerve and the medial is by obturator nerve. So femoral nerve having muscular branch and cutaneous branch, Muscular splints replace quadriceps femoris like vastus lateralis, vastus intermedius, and vastus medialis, sartorius muscle, the longest muscle in the body, pectineus muscle, iliacus muscle is supplied by femoral nerve, whereas cutaneous splints supplies sensory gives sensory innervation for the skin of anterior and medial thigh muscles and the skins of medial leg and foot. Whereas obturator nerve gives muscular branch and cutaneous branch. Muscular branch supplies adductor magnus muscle, adductor longus and brevis muscle, and gracilis muscle. Whereas the cutaneous branch gives sensory innervation for the skin of the medial thigh. So this is lumbar, from lumbar 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this is lumbar plexus. Gives this branch obturator nerve, and this branch is lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, and this branch is genitofemoral nerve, and this branch is iliohypogastric nerve from lumbar 1, and ilioinguinal nerve is this one, this is also from lumbar 1. So iliohypogastric and ilioinguinal nerves arise from lumbar 1, and genitofemoral nerve is from lumbar 1 and lumbar 2 femoral nerve. The other is lateral femoral cutaneous nerve. These arise from lumbar 2 and lumbar 3. And obturator nerve is this one. Obturator nerve, as you see, lumbar 2, lumbar 3, lumbar 4. Obturator nerve. Whereas femoral nerve is the largest nerve here. Arise from the lumbar 2, lumbar 3, lumbar 3, posterior division. And lumbosacral trunk. This is lumbosacral trunk. So, iliohypogastric nerve, ilioinguinal nerve, genitofemoral nerve, lateral femoral cutaneous nerve, obturator nerve, and femoral nerve all are the branches of lumbar plexus. So, the branches of lumbar plexus. It supplies the lower abdomen. By the way, hypogastric nerve and ilioinguinal nerve is supplies the lower abdomen. Genitofemoral, genital area, and these two are the lower limb thigh area. The fourth is sacral plexus. It is formed by anterior rami of spinal nerves from lumbar 4 up to sacral 4. Similar to the lumbar plexus, the sacral plexus has both roots and divisions. So nerves which arise from sacral plexus is the first one, superior gluteal nerve. This is gives motor or muscular branch to gluteus medius, gluteus maximus, and tensor fascia lata muscles, whereas inferior gluteal muscle gives muscular branch for gluteus maximus. The third one is pudendal nerve. This is gives for supply the most of the skin and muscles of the perineum, external anal sphincter, and also used for sexual satisfaction, which is gives sensory nerve on the clitoris and the glans penis, is supplied by pudendal nerve. So sacral is for lumbar 4 up to sacral 4. From lumbar 4 up to sacral 4 is formed by sacral plexus. So in the sacral plexus, superior gluteal nerve, lumbosacral, and inferior gluteal nerve, and common fibular nerve and tibial nerve, that means it's sciatic nerve, posterior femoral cutaneous nerve, pudendal nerve, sciatic nerve, these all are branches of sacral plexus. So by the way, sciatic nerve, it will sciatic nerve, then later it will divide into tibial nerve and common fibular, tibial and common fibular nerve is considered as sciatic nerve. By the way, sciatic nerve is the longest nerve in the body. So in the when it arises from this region, it is the thickest and the widest nerve when arises this one. So when we should be careful when we give intramuscular injection on the buttock. So mostly it's a recommended region is upper outer quadrant, in order to not to touch the sciatic nerve. Upper outer quadrant is a recommended region for injection. So all these branches are considered as branches of sacral plexus. The first is superior gluteal, the second is inferior gluteal, the third is pudendal nerve, the fourth is sciatic nerve. The thickest and the longest nerve in our body, it branches into two branches the tibial and common cranial nerve. So after popliteal fossa, it will sciatic nerve divide into tibial and common cranial nerve. So it will supply muscles of the leg and the foot. So the tibial nerve gives muscular branch muscles of the back of the thigh, like semitendineous, semimembranous, longates of biceps femoris, hamstring parts of adductor magnus is supplied by sciatic nerve, but we can assume that it's tibial part. So the muscles of the back of the leg, it is purely supplied by division of tibial nerve, like gastrocnemius muscle, soleus muscle, plantaris muscle, tibialis posterior muscle. So and all these muscles are supplied by tibial nerve. So the other is cutaneous branch. Cutaneous branch supplies the skin on the posterior surface of the leg and soles of the foot. And common fibular, or another name is spinal nerve, gives muscular branch for short heads of biceps femoris muscle, and classified into deep plenar nerve and superficial plenar nerve. There are muscles supplied by superficial plenar nerve and deep plenar nerve. So the exits of spinal nerves we have seen later before. So cervical nerves from C1 to C7 leaves the vertebral canal above the vertebra of the same member, whereas C8 nerves leaves below C7 vertebra. And the thoracic and lumbar nerves leaves the vertebra of the same member below. Sacral 1 up to 4 nerves leaves through anterior and posterior sacral foramina, whereas S5 and posterior nerve leaves vertebral canal through sacral hiatus. So the nerves of the upper cervical nerves are short and horizontal, but the lower are longer and more oblique because of spinal cord is shorter than vertebral column. So autonomic nervous system, involuntary factors including smooth, by the way, autonomic nervous system is a place involuntary part organs like smooth muscles, cardiac muscles, glands, which is regulated by autonomic nervous system. Also, autonomic nervous system is composed of portions of both central and peripheral nervous system. It functions independently and without person's conscious control, so responsible for maintaining hypotosis. So this is parasympathetic, this is sympathetic. So this is somatic nervous system. So this is heavily minanti raxo. This is skeletal muscle. This is like this one is smooth muscle. So autonomic nervous system helps to regulate heart rate, blood pressure, body temperature, digestion, waste elimination. We cannot control. In the autonomic nervous system, two neurons span the distance from CNS to effector. There are two neurons. The first begin with soma, cell body in the central nervous system, and terminates in the ganglion of peripheral nervous system. It is called preganglionic neuron or presynaptic. The first neuron is presynaptic neuron, whereas the second neuron is postsynaptic neuron or postsynaptic neuron. So after if this is synapse, the nerve before this one is presynaptic neuron, the nerve after cell body is postsynaptic neuron. So there are structural division of autonomic nervous system divided into sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. Sympathetic division is called thoracolumbar division of autonomic nervous system because it arises from thoracic and lumbar region of the spinal cord. Preganglionic neuron exit from T1 up to lumbar 2. Whereas parasympathetic is arise from the brain part or the craniosacral region, which arise from cranial nerve 3, 7, 9, and 10, and sacral 2 up to sacral 4. So now the last portion is section is early development of the nervous system. It's embryonic part. So before the formation of the nervous system in the embryo, three main cell layers became differentiated: the inner layer, the middle layer, and the outer layer. The middle layer, will develop into endoderm, whereas the middle is mesoderm. The third is ectoderm. The third layer is ectoderm. So, two, three layers will be formed: endoderm, mesoderm, and ectoderm. Endoderm, which is developed into gastrointestinal tract, lungs, and liver, the inner parts of the body. Mesoderm and developed into the muscle, connective tissues, and vascular system. Whereas the ectoderm developed into nervous system and skin. So, in another way, nervous system is arise from the ectoderm. So during the third week of development, the ectoderm on the dorsal surface of embryo between primitive node and bucopharyngeal membrane became thickened and formed the neural plate. So from the ectoderm, neural plate is formed. Then the plate, which is pear-shaped and wider cranially, develops longitudinally into nerve neural groove. The groove now deepens so that it is bounded on either side by neural folds. So neural plate develops into neural groove. Neural groove also develops into neural folds. So with further development, the neural fold fuse and converting into neural groove into neural tube. So first ectoderm, then neural plate, then neural groove, then neural fold, finally it changed into neural tube. So fusion starts at about midpoint along the groove and extends cranially and caudally, so that in the earliest stage the cavity of the tube remains in communication with amniotic cavity through anterior and posterior neuropores. So anterior neuropore closes first, then 2 days later the posterior neuropore closes. Thus normally the neural tube closure is complete within 28 days or 1 month. So anterior neuropore closes first. So when we see the development, then ectoderm, then neural plate, then neural groove, then it will change into neural fold, finally it will change into neural tube. Then the neural tube develops into the CNS, meaning neural tube divided into two parts. After above, this one is cranial part, this one is caudal part. The cranial part develops into brain, the caudal part develops into spinal cord. So the cephalic end of the neural tube later forms three dilatations called primary brain vesicles, the cephalic end, whereas the caudal portion of the neural tube becomes spinal cord. So neural tube finally develops into CNS. So this is at the beginning, then changed into neural crests, then neural crest will form into different shapes, finally into neural fold. This is fusion of neural folds. Neural fold changed into neural tube. This is anterior neuropore. This is posterior neuropore. Then this open area is closed. Then later, after 2 days, this posterior neuropore closes. This is will develop into spinal cord. This will develop into brain. But if this neuropolis does not close, then the defect, neural tube defect, will be developed. Neural tube defect will be developed. So this is three parts of the brain. This is forebrain, this is midbrain, and this is hindbrain. Finally, this is spinal cord. So this is cells. So development of the nervous system develops from ectoderm, then for neural plate, then neural fold, then neural tube. So neural tube having cephalic portion and caudal portion develop into spinal cord. So spinal contains the canal is known as central canal, which important for circulation of cerebrospinal fluid. The neural tube and the cephalic portion will form three primary brain vesicles. The first one is prosencephalon, the second is mesencephalon, the third one is robocephalon. The prosencephalon divide into telencephalon and diencephalon. The telencephalon adult brain structure, telencephalon in the adult will change into cerebrum. The diencephalon will change to thalamus, hypothalamus, and epithalamus. whereas mesencephalon changed into mesencephalon or midbrain. So in the adult is the same midbrain. Robencephalon changed into metencephalon and melencephalon. Metencephalon will develop into pons and cerebellum. Melencephalon will develop into medulla oblongata. So when we say neural canal in the brain, first and second ventricle, that means lateral ventricle is found in the cerebellum between two cerebral hemispheres. The third ventricle is found in the dencephalon, in the thalamus, and cerebral aqueduct is found in the midbrain. Cerebral aqueduct is a canal which connects third ventricle with fourth ventricle, and fourth ventricle is found on the three structures between pons, cerebellum, and medulla oblongata. Ventricle which is found on the three structures is fourth ventricle. So, finally, primary vesicle having forebrain vesicle, midbrain vesicle, hindbrain vesicle. Forebrain vesicle will develop into prosencephalon or forebrain. This is telencephalon. Adult structure, cerebral hemisphere, basal ganglia and hippocampus. And dencephalon, adult structure, thalamus, hypothalamus, pineal body and infundibulum. And midbrain, mesencephalon, midbrain, adult structure, tectum, tegmentum, cross cerebri. Robencephalon and hindbrain changed into metencephalon, melencephalon. Metencephalon, pons and cerebrum, melencephalon into medulla oblongata. So, some defects in central nervous system. So, the first defect is, by the way, anterior neural pore or anterior posterior neural pore, which does not close during the fetus or embryo. That defect is known as neural tube defect. Neural tube defect divided into three. The one is anencephaly, the other is encephalocele. This is cranial part defect, whereas the third type of division is spina bifida. Spina bifida is a defect of spinal cord, and anencephaly and encephalocele is the defect of the brain, whereas spinal bifida is the defect of the spinal cord. So neural tube defect. Neural tube defects are the common. Neural tube defects are the common congenital anomaly that result from early malformation in the development of spinal cord and brain. Yeah, malformation in the development of brain is anencephaly and encephalocele, whereas malformation in the development of spinal cord is spina bifida. It is related to substantial mortality, morbidity, and disability, and psychological and economic costs. It leads to this one. So the other type of defect is, as I told you, spina bifida. Spina bifida is a defect in the spinal cord, as I told you. So the other is, in general, congenital anomaly. By the way, spinal neural tube defect is a part of congenital anomaly or congenital birth defect. Congenital birth defect is a partial or complex structural and functional defect during intrauterine life. This congenital anomaly, we can say congenital defect, or you can say birth defect or congenital malformation. The other is anencephaly. As I told you, anencephaly is a severe anomaly of the brain, not spinal cord. That results from failure of cephalic part of the neural tube. To close during the fourth week. You understand? The caudal part, failure of the caudal part of the neural tube to close is spinal bifida. But the failure of the cephalic part of the neural tube is known as anencephaly. As I told you, neural tube would have two portions, cephalic part and caudal part. Caudal part developed into spinal cord, cephalic part developed into brain. So the failure of the cephalic part of the neural tube to close during fourth week is known as anencephaly. Then encephalosis. Encephalosis is the same thing. Encephalosis is a birth, is a birth abnormally associated with the skull deformities defined by partial absence of the bone fusion that a portion of the brain protrudes. Meaning, in the case of encephalosis, it is skull deformity, cranial deformity. So the cranial is open, so the brain protrudes. So in this case, it is a neural tube defect. This is also controversial, having a neural tube defect and other than neural tube defect, there is a controversial between scholars. Encephalosis, whether it's a part of neural tube defect or not. This is all about central nervous system. This is section 3, part of the central nervous system. Thank you very much for your attention and for watching this video. And if you have any comment, you can give us, and we will improve our work based on your comment, and we will prepare another course based on our chapters based on your comments. And if you subscribe this channel, you will get the next chapters or the next videos, and so we will get also another course by providing an extended portion of CNS, by very vast, either for other health science students or medical students. So we will get it by another PowerPoint or video about nervous system, and you will get it another course of anatomy like skeletal system and other systems in this channel. So don't forget to subscribe this channel. Thank you very much for watching this video. Have a nice time.